everyone can get to the 90%, or even if they're 100%, whatever, you have to go above and beyond where other people are not willing to go. That's what separates you from the rest.
Yeah.
That's what gets a business off the ground. And we talk around getting businesses off the ground all the time, and kind of like using the metaphor of flying a plane. Like, you need that energy. You need so much freaking energy and power to get that plane off the ground and get it into the air. Then yeah, you can coast a little bit once it's up there, but you have to get that energy from somewhere. And, you know, we're not glorifying the hustle, and we really believe in like a, you know, holistic approach to business. And you have to really work your freaking ass off if you want to start and grow a business. Welcome to the Boss Babe podcast, the place where we share with you the real behind the scenes of building successful businesses, achieving peak performance, and learning how to balance it all. I'm Danielle Canty, co-founder of Boss Babe, and today I am joined by
Natalie Ellis, also co-founder. How are you feeling?
Well, I'm going to be honest with you. I'm feeling a tad sassy this morning.
A tad?
Just a tad, because I had a 7 a.m. meeting with my UK divorce attorneys. Just how everyone wants to start their day. And let me tell you, divorce is freaking stressful at the best of times. And when you have the money, it's even more stressful.
It's even worse. You actually don't often hear about it that way around.
No,
you often hear about the man being the one with the money and...
Correct. And my divorce attorneys love it. They're like, oh yes, this would be a great case to go to court, because there's no examples. Like, I'm like a full researcher. So I'm like, right, I now need to become a divorce attorney. It's my mission to understand UK divorce law. So I'm like reading all of these papers, and I'm like, where? It's like, most of the time, every single one I found, and I know there's going to be cases outside of this, but it's the male who has the money. Mm-hmm. And so I think we're moving into a new era where women have the money, and we're going to be seeing more and more of this. And when you're a woman who's worked hard for money with no children, law is not really in your favor. Got to be honest with you.
Yeah, and this ties in quite nicely, I think, to today's podcast, because what we really want to talk about is this whole conversation, because you made your money with no help, just putting that out there. You worked your ass off, and there's a different, I think there's a big difference between between some people. Some people are just inherently motivated and are gonna make their own success no matter what stands in their way, and others won't. They are so married to their excuses that they don't get there. And so what I would love to talk about on today's episode is that conversation we were having, where we were starting to dissect what it really took for us to get here. And like, we obviously still have a while to go, but I think what we've been able to achieve both individually and together is really amazing considering our age. And when we both sat down to dissect like what really got us here, even before we knew each other, our kind of story, the way we got here, was exactly the same. Isn't that interesting?
Yeah, I think you just touched on something there, which is like, we've never bought into excuses. And I think that is a key differentiator for people who are successful and people who are not. Because it's so easy to say, oh, this didn't work out because of someone over here. I didn't achieve at this because this situation happened. We've never, ever done that. And there's a piece of it that's around taking responsibility for your actions on a daily, which I have been around both kinds of people. You are someone who takes responsibility for your actions on the daily. You're like, if something doesn't work out, you're not pointing fingers, you're not blaming other people. You're like, okay, how can I fix this? How can I take control? And that's exactly how I am. And I honestly think that's the biggest difference. The people who are like, oh, well, you know, I couldn't do this because I had this going on at the time, or, you know, I wanted to achieve this, but this person didn't deliver on what they said they were going to. Those are the people that don't get to where they want to get to, because they're too busy hiding behind their excuses.
Yeah, I think that's a really big one. And at the end of the day, in business, I mean, just generally in life, to be honest, there's always going to be something in your way. And I think there's a few misconceptions about success. And I think the first one is that you have to know where you're going. You have to have this really clear, big vision. You have to have all this clarity. And it just, speaking for me, like at the beginning of my career, when I left uni and when I was experimenting with lots of different things, I had no fucking idea where I was going. I really, really didn't. But I didn't let that hold me back. My approach was, okay, if I show up every single day and I do my best and I lean towards the things that feel good and I take opportunities, like I say yes to opportunities that I don't really know where they're going to take me, but I say yes anyway, and I always do my best without this like feeling of entitlement or anything, like I'll work any job, I'll start anywhere, I will roll my sleeves up and like work for someone for free if it's going to get me the experience that is going to help me. And I feel like that's how I've gotten here. It's just every day one foot in front of the other, doing my best. Because I think, you know, back then if I'd allowed the idea of, oh, I don't know where I'm going, I don't know what I want to do, I don't know what I want to be, to hold me back, then I would never have gotten here, because I didn't know I wanted to be doing this.
Yeah, and I think that's a misconception. Like, a lot of people think that they have to have everything ironed out. They have to know exactly what they are going to create in their lives. They have to know where they're going to be in 5 years, 10 years, 20 years. You and I are all about like setting the goals, but there also is a point where you don't know what opportunities are going to present yourself. So if I think around when I first started my chiropractic business, did I ever think in a million years I would have an online business? No, absolutely not.
Did you ever think you'd be on a podcast?
No, I didn't. I didn't even think I was going to live in America. That was never on my radar. And so I think it's like when I met you in San Diego, again, I never went with the, oh, I'm going to San Diego to this Brendan Burchard conference because I'm going to meet my business partner and then we're going to start Boss Babe and do all these things. No, that didn't happen. So yes, I always had a vision of like, I want to create something for my life and I'm not going to let anything stop me. Did I exactly know what I wanted to create? No, I just knew I wanted to work for myself. I did not want to feel like I had a glass ceiling. I did not want to feel like someone was in control of my income. And I knew after a while of doing chiropractic, I wanted location independence. So I just knew those values that I wanted to achieve. How I was going to get there, I had no freaking idea. But I was willing to try things and experiment with things and see where that got me. And I think a lot of people, they get stuck with perfect action versus imperfect action. And I also think that's what you and I are really good at. We're really good at taking action and it sometimes works out great and it sometimes doesn't. But the fact that we make more moves, we do more action, we do more things means the probability of our success drastically increases. So if you think about it, like if you're only every 10 days making like two or three plays, you have to hope that those, and you're looking for perfect plays, you have to hope that those plays are perfect. Whereas if over 10 days, you're making 20 plays, you don't know if they're perfect, but you're doing them anyway. The probability is three of those are going to be perfect. The rest were shit and they've not mattered, but at least you've done something. And I think that's the biggest mistake I see a lot of people making, is just not making the, taking the actions and making the plays in the first place.
Yeah, and let's talk about that idea of making plays. The concept of making plays without expectation, again, was something that came up in our conversation, because I know for me, when I was doing Instagram back in the day, to be honest, I was doing most of it for free for people. And I was, you know, learning along the way. And I was honestly just grateful to have the opportunity. I had no big expectations of how that was going to pay off. I wasn't like demanding these big salaries or whatever. I was like, yeah, I want to learn. And so I'm going to just do this. And remember our first interaction where I was doing a Bossbabe membership and I was looking for someone to do a success kit and someone had fallen through and our friend Nick was like, oh, I have someone. I think she'd probably do it. And you stayed up all night with no expectation. Yeah.
The message came through at 5 p.m. No, 6 p.m. because I was driving home from my chiropractic clinic. So actually maybe it was 6:30. I think it was a Friday night.
I think it might have been.
It was a Friday night. And this opportunity came through and I was like, right, it's like 6:30 p.m. I've got nothing.
Stop. You just said this opportunity came through. That's thinking. Yeah. That's your mindset.
Yeah, straight away.
So yeah, you're but right. Keep going. Good call out. Yeah.
Yeah. And I was like, wow, this opportunity came through, but it's 6:30 at night and you were 8 hours behind because you were in San Francisco, I think at the time. And you needed it by like 5 p.m. your time. So I was like, okay, I've got basically 7 hours to do this thing. I got home and I had never created a keynote presentation like that. And like, I'd done like slideshows, but I'd never recorded anything. So I'm like trying to figure out how I record this thing. And then it was like the simple of hurdles. I didn't even know how to transfer a file that big.
I remember.
Because you couldn't do it by email. Like, I had to use WeTransfer. I'd never heard of it. But the point was, I was like, right, there's an opportunity. I'm going to say yes, and then I'm going to figure it out later. And I just stayed up, and I literally worked until like 5 a.m., got it to you, and then I slept for 4 hours. And then what was the thing? I was actually in clinic on the Saturday morning. So I actually was in clinic at 8 a.m. till 12 again. And I was like, if I can just get through those 4 hours in clinic, then I can go home and sleep. And that's what I did.
Yeah, and I remember, I didn't remember that it was you until we were actually in business together.
I think it was like years later. Yeah, I remember when I did this, you were like, that was you? And I was like, yeah.
I didn't remember that it was you, because there was just a lot going on at the time, but I remembered the person who did that. And I remember you didn't tell me you were working through the night.
No,
I didn't know where you're actually located. I didn't know any of this. I just know that I needed help with something and this landed on my desk. And what I also knew was there was no ask associated with it, which was so interesting. And I find that I've done similar things too. When I've seen an opportunity come up, I'm like, oh, I would love to help that person. And I think it'd be a really good experience for me, or maybe it's going to help get my name out there, whatever it is. And just because you're not being paid doesn't mean that I like half-assed it. Go all the way in, do it as if I'm being paid, you know, $10,000 to create this thing.
Do you know what I think it is? It was that opportunity was given to lots of people, and I was the only one that said yes. And it's part of being successful in business is going where the 90% won't. I genuinely believe that. It's everyone can get to the 90%. Or even if they're 100%, whatever. You have to go above and beyond where other people are not willing to go. That's what separates you from the rest.
Yeah.
That's what gets a business off the ground. And we talk around getting businesses off the ground all the time, and kind of like using the metaphor of flying a plane. Like, you need that energy. You need so much freaking energy and power to get that plane off the ground and get it into the air. Then, yeah, you can coast a little bit once it's up there. But you have to get that energy from somewhere. And, you know, we're not glorifying the hustle, and we really believe in like a holistic approach to business, and you have to really work your freaking ass off if you want to start and grow a business. You are going to have to make sacrifices. And I heard this saying a little while ago that's kind of like, the hard choices now set you up for the easier life later, versus the easier choices now set you up for the harder life later. And that's also what I think around. I'm like, what am I willing to sacrifice now so I can reap the rewards in later life, versus the other way around?
Yeah, I completely agree. And also, I don't know if this is controversial, but I'm going to share it anyway. Maybe it is. Please don't cancel me.
Please don't.
The other day, so we hired that house and we were shooting for 3 days. We were doing some really fun creative ads and batching content and all that stuff. And I'd put on my Instagram looking for an assistant to come and support over the 3 days. And someone had responded and said, hey, I'm really interested. This would be so interesting for me because I'm trying to learn the ropes. I'm brand new to this online world and I'm really interested in learning the ropes. And I was like, oh, great. And she was super young. And initially my first thought was, oh, it would be great to have someone come in that we can actually show things to, and like have
her priceless advice.
Yeah, have her just be able to really see how things go down. And of course we wanted to pay her. So I sent back, that sounds great. Would love to show you the ropes. We'll spend time doing that. Can you send me over your day rate? And I'd seen her CV too, and she didn't have any experience. She really was brand new to it. And her day rate was a very, very high six-figure salary day rate. And I remember looking at it and I just said to her, like, this is way beyond my budget. I'm not going to go ahead this time. And I appreciate the willingness to put yourself out there like that. But to me, that I just couldn't have imagined myself doing that. Like, if I was really interested in learning the ropes, I would have done my research of like, what's a reasonable date rate for a shoot assistant, and put that forward.
Yeah.
This was probably like 10 times at least the normal amount of a day rate. Yeah. And when I said that, like, hey, this is above budget, she was like, well, tell me your budget and I'll be willing to work with it. And I was like, no, like, it just passed for me. It's the energy of like entitlement. Like, she would have been there unhappy because she thought that we should have paid her a lot more. And it was like, it just was crazy to me. And it's things like that. Like, I just think back to when I was getting started, even now, So like, I'm really wanting to learn the ropes of more creative stuff. And if I'd seen someone that I really respect post on Instagram saying they want to shoot assistant for that day and I want to learn stuff from them, I'd be the first to put my hand up.
I think that's the thing. Okay. And so say, like, I definitely, this is a very interesting conversation because, like I say, we are here saying like women should get paid what they're worth, right?
Yeah.
Absolutely. 100%. That's never, ever up for negotiation. And we're also saying, energy exchanges come in so many different forms. Mm-hmm. There is a monetary form and there is an experience and opportunity and connection and all these things that also has a lot of value to it as well. And I think sometimes people don't quite grasp that concept. And just like you were saying, I was literally thinking today, if someone said to me, Danielle, we are running this, come and volunteer, if you will come. I go and speak at things all the time, mainly because I actually think it's really good experience for me and yeah. I don't charge. I'll go and speak and I'm like, this is a good opportunity.
And you always
I never know who I'm going to meet.
Yeah.
Like I want to put myself out there. Other people are doing it and I believe, you know, and sometimes I was going to say believe in the cause, sometimes not even a cause, but like, you know, I'm just going to do it because I'm like, that's an opportunity. I'm going to get in a room with new types of people. And I see the value in that. And I think that's a challenge that a lot of people don't actually recognize is there was a lot of value. And not just saying that about us, but there's a lot of value around being around certain people. You mm-hmm. are the average of the five people that you spend the most time with. And I will always now, like, I'll go and do stuff for free. I don't charge. Or, you know, if that opportunity came up for you, like you say, you're like, hey, someone says I'm a TikToker with 20 million subscribers.
Yeah, or like you can like, come yeah, behind like, the scenes and like watch me do TikTok. I wouldn't charge, I would volunteer, but also I'm in the financial position where I can do that. However, if I was early in my career, I would do the research of like what's reasonable to charge because I would have need my expenses paid yeah. and I would have asked for that.
Yeah.
Now it's nice to be able to say like we could volunteer, which is great, but even we had a great budget set aside and yeah. things like that, but you've got to be willing to put the work in and to start, like if you're brand new to an industry, be willing to start from the beginning and figure it out all as you it. Go along. And I think resourcefulness comes into that too. Like, so take this for example, we're recording in person, we're filming all this stuff, and we were just chatting with Hunter, who's helping us set this all up because we haven't got a fucking clue what we're doing. And I was like sitting mesmerized watching him set the whole thing up, and I was like, how did you learn how to do this? And he was like, to be honest, it's the first time I've done it like this, but I just have been reading stuff and figuring it out, and I'm resourceful. And I'm just like, that is everything. Being willing to be resourceful, to roll your sleeves up, to yeah. get on Google. Yeah. And I remember setting Google up a supplement it. Company, got on Google. I was like, how to set up supplement company, how to find factory. I built my entire business off the back of Google yeah. and it was fine.
Yeah, it is. It's that resourcefulness, that going, hang on, I'm going to set my mind to something and I'm going to sit here until I figure it out. Whether it's yeah. on Google or the society, you know?
Well, the society is definitely an easier option than Google these days.
It really is. But yeah, no, I think it's a really, it's an interesting conversation and I'm glad we're having it. That's what this podcast is around. Like, you know, mine, it's just mine and yours opinions right now. And like, message us, let us know your opinion on whether you would, you know, take a lesser pay over a weekend to learn something or not. I'm curious actually.
Yeah,
what people's feedback is. I know what mine would have been. And like you say, it wasn't even as if it was for free. It was good pay associated with it. Just not a six-figure salary pay for that type of role.
Yeah, exactly. And I am glad we're having these conversations because I really love to go back and put myself in the mindset of like me in university. Like, you know, I remember being so confused, so worried, like couldn't even imagine what my career was going to look like. I just lacked so much clarity, but I never lacked the motivation. Mm-hmm. And I think it's complete BS that people who are successful wake up motivated every single day. There are some days, like some people say, work for yourself and you'll never work a day in your life. I call bullshit. You will work many days of your life. There are so many days that I wake up and I really cannot be bothered yeah. to get to work, or the kind of things that I'm doing, I'm not really enjoying, or there's like shit going on in the company. Yeah. Like it happens. It's always going to happen. And I do it anyway. Like pour a cup of coffee, like messy bun, get shit done. That stuff is real. And that's how you stay motivated, is you get it done regardless, you get momentum and you just show up.
I wonder if like social media has given the wrong impression as well, because the highlight reel, it's like, oh yeah, you see these like motivational pages, including ours or other people's, or these, you know, people like you say who are sometimes appearing like they're always positive, that they always have their shit together, that everything in their life is absolutely perfect. Mm. And that just couldn't be further from the truth. Like that's why, in all honesty, I show up here and I'll talk about my divorce and I'll talk about like—
I had to pull you out of a closet.
Yeah, like this morning I was literally crying my eyes out. I had a 7 a.m. legal meeting.
In your closet.
In my closet. Yeah, because you had to have like hair lady here and I didn't want to— she saw me crying, but
it was very visible. But then Danielle was in the closet.
I tried to run the tap so you didn't hear me.
No, I couldn't hear anything, but I was like wanting to come check on you. I was like, Danielle. So I came in your room. I couldn't see you and I was guessing you were in the closet. So I came back out. I went in, I think I went in 3 or 4 times. And then I came in a final time. I opened the closet door. I'm like, you know, we really got to get to work. And you're like, I'll come out soon. And then another 20 minutes and Hunter was here. And I said, Hunter, I was like, psyching myself up. I'm going to go in again. I really need to get our rallied up. We need to go. And then just at that moment you came out and I was like, okay,
yeah,
we got to go.
That's the other thing. I was holding myself responsible to showing up for this day. So I had to have this call. And I guess this is the other thing. I had a call at 7 a.m. so that I did not interrupt this podcast day.
And your day's not going to finish till about 10 p.m.
yeah,
tonight.
Because I was like, I need to do what it takes. And this is one thing. So many people wait for the perfect moment to do something. Fucking newsflash. That perfect moment will never exist. It is never the perfect time to get married or get divorced or have children or start that business or buy that house. Yeah. You have to just commit to it and then figure it out afterwards. I think waiting for the perfect moments is like one of the biggest things that stop people in their business or stop people making that career change, whatever it is. They think, oh, I'll do it in 6 months. I'll do it in a year. I'll do it at another point because things will be easier then. No, life's a roller coaster. Doesn't work like that. You just have to figure it out anyway. And that's what this podcast is about, is sharing those sides of this. Like I literally do not have everything figured out. I have days where
I'm in closets crying.
But you know what, I pick myself up, throw some cold water on my face, and I literally threw some cold water on my face. I'm like, Danielle, you gotta switch moods now. You gotta like flip
gotta
this
pay
side
for that divorce somehow.
Yeah, you gotta come out the other side of this. Yeah. Like I could have made the excuse. I could have been like, Natalie, I can't do this. Like I don't want to. I've had a really shit time. I'm just really upset. I can't do this. But I was like, no, I owe myself better. I'm not letting this stand in my way. I'm just going to be like, right, I get to take control of my day. I get to do one step in front of the other. I don't have to think about all the podcasts that we're recording today. I just have to be like, right, all I need to do now is put my makeup on. So what? Stop crying. Put my makeup on and get out there for our solo first. And that's what I did. I'm like, right, then I'll cross the next bridge. And yeah. You know what? When you start getting into the States, you start going into more of a positive spiral. Now I'm like, my mood now is so different to how I was like 2 hours ago. I'm like completely different state. But it's like you choose not to make an excuse. You choose to take control and you choose to get on with it.
Yeah. And I can't emphasize enough the power of having a business partner, you guys, because Danielle came out and I was prepping stuff. I was like, yeah. Oh, I already prepped for that. We're good. I was like moving things around. Like I was already going and I know I just needed to tag Danielle in. And it was the same for me a few weeks ago. I don't know if you remember when I was also in LA and I was having a really bad day and I'd been crying. I was in a shitty mood. But we had a coaching call and I knew there was women that we really needed to show up for and I needed to pull myself together for, but I really wasn't feeling it. And I remember you being like, you know what? I'm going to take the lead on this one. Just be present. Just show up and you'll slowly get into it. And I did. Like Danielle opened it. She kicked it off. And all of a sudden my mood changed. And I was like really able to see why I was then, what I was showing up for, who I was showing up for, and got out of my own way. But that's always going to happen. But I am definitely grateful that we have a business partner. Again, another big reason we create the society, because I don't know that. I actually do know 100% we wouldn't be where we are today without each other. Like we're great in individually and we are a force together. And even yesterday we were doing all this brainstorming and like one of us has a blind spot, the other person's got it covered. Yeah. Or if we don't, the other person's like, you know what? I'm going to take that blind spot. I'm going to go and learn how to do it. You take that one, you go learn how to do that, and we divide and conquer. Yeah.
And it's not even saying that you have to have like a business partner. Like, I think businesses can be successful, but you do need somebody who you can turn to when things are rough. And like, even with our friends, Sarah and Anna, who are coming on later, you know, there's times where it's like, do you know what? I just need that friend to turn to. And I think that's also what the society has created. Like, there's so many people in there. They're not necessarily in business together, but it's like, oh, do you know what? I have someone who also has their own business that gets this situation. Yeah. Or also have someone that is an influencer, also have someone that is doing the similar thing. No one else in my family or friendship groups in school is doing that, but I have these people that now get me, and I can like bounce ideas off, or I can share this problem so that I can move through it. And there's so much power in that. Yeah. You know, business and entrepreneurship can be really freaking lonely if you're not careful.
And listen, you guys, if you're interested in joining the society and you're a little bit on the fence, we've put together a free trial so you can actually join, no obligation. You can get in there and see what it's about and actually see if it's a good fit. So if you're interested, we'll put the link in the show notes and you can take the trial and see what it's about. But it's a big reason that we created it. You know, if you're willing to roll your sleeves up, get resourceful, do the work, we can help you shortcut that and put some amazing people around you.
Yeah, because I think, you know, we spoke about the roller coaster today and all those pieces, but it really makes me so grateful that I actually have my own business. Mm-hmm. In times like this, like, wow, I actually get to, you know, have a business partner that supports me versus having to drive to a job where,
yeah.
Imagine, I mean, I would have been late this morning.
Yeah,
what, because
yeah.
of personal drama? That would have been embarrassing. So it's like, you know, you get to make those allowances and those movements to suit you at that point after you've, you know, put your work in, but it's
exactly.
Good.
Okay, you guys, I hope you loved this episode. Danielle, I really took on some of your sass. I enjoyed it. Thanks for showing up with all that sass.
I know that Leo in my sign came out with a fire today.
Are we both Leo rising or
no,
you're Leo moon?
No, I'm Leo rising, you're Leo moon.
Oh.
I'm Pisces moon, which was why I'm a bit more sensitive than you are.
Oh, yeah. I'm a Sagittarius. Okay.
Yeah.
Love it. Well, you guys, thank you so much for listening. Please give us 5 stars on iTunes. Leave us a review.
No less.
Yeah, no, definitely no less, because Danielle's sass will come after you. And share this episode if you found it helpful.
Yeah.
Bye.